May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be always pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer.
Amen. Amen.
Take a seat. There are two images that I want to look at in today's gospel in relation to Peter, Simon, who becomes known as Peter. And it's important for us to have a think about these things, because we, in our creeds, we talk about the one holy Catholic and apostolic church. And we understand ourselves, the church, as being in the line and tradition and teachings of the apostles. The apostles were taught this, they taught that, and our teaching is in that same line and tradition. So it's important that we understand perhaps how they should be thought of. And the first I wanted to talk about was this notion of the rock. On this rock I will build my church. And in your pew bulletin, this week's reflective colouring is in fact a black and white picture of Mont Saint-Michel in France, which was built on a rock. And if you're ever feeling like exercising your jealousy muscles, talk to Sandy about it, because she's been there. And so when she came across this reading, she went, we've got to have that. And it's an amazing image of this rock in the ocean, and on it is built a church. It's important to have a good foundation for the walls that you're going to build. But it occurs to me that walls can have two functions, primarily. And they're often quite similar. One function of walls is to hold up roofs. It's hard to put a roof up with no walls, because it falls down. And roofs are important because they provide shelter. They keep the rain, they keep the sun off, they give us a safe space. So that's one function of walls. And the other function of walls is, well, I suppose, a little bit like the understanding that some people have of the Great Wall of China. It's there to protect, to stop. It's as a barrier. Walls can be fences. So the question we then have to ask ourselves is, if we are, like Peter, rocks that God uses to build, should the church be constructing itself with walls for roofs that people might shelter? Or do we have a responsibility to construct walls to protect? And I want to talk about the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Have you've seen the cartoons, haven't you? And St. Peter's there, and there's clouds, there's fluffy white clouds, and there's the gates, and they're golden, and Peter's there. And he's got a key. Peter's symbol is the two overlocking keys. Here's the thing about the kingdom of heaven and the lock and keys. If we built a wall that separates, then what happens is we find ourselves with the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and the locks on the outside of the gate. So if we decide to lock the gates of heaven, we find ourselves locked out. If we are in the business of locking people out of the kingdom of heaven, we're in the business of locking ourselves out of the kingdom of heaven. It's important that we understand and think about that. do we build supports for ceilings, supports for rooms, or do we build walls to keep people out of the kingdom of heaven? I know if I was a rock and I got to choose, I would choose to be one of those that was building walls for rooms. That's what it means to be part, to be in the tradition of Peter, who was known as the rock. So what's the moment where Jesus recognizes and proclaims that Peter is the rock? He says to his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" This is an odd term that Jesus uses, that is self-referential. He's talking about himself in the third person, and scholars argue, what does he mean by that? Some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, others Jeremiah, one of the prophets. It's pretty good company for Jesus to be keeping in a lot of ways. These are ones who have been profoundly courageous in proclaiming the kingdom of God. Who do you say I am? And this is the moment in which Simon becomes Peter. You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Messiah and Christ are the same word, roughly. One's Hebrew or Aramaic, one's Greek. A lot of people think Christ is Jesus' surname. Like my surname, Schmidt, his was Christ. No, it's a title. It means anointed. It means chosen by God. So there are two things there that are being affirmed. One is that Jesus was chosen by God. Now here's another interesting thing. Not only are we rocks in the walls. How many of you remember your baptism? I don't. I mean, I was small. I was apparently cute. Smaller people often are. But we do this thing with oil. With small people when they're baptized, even bigger ones. When you're confirmed, you have oil placed in your hands. When we were ordained, the bishop puts oil on our hands. We are, lowercase m, Messiahs. We too have been anointed by God to proclaim, as did Jesus, Elijah, John the Baptist, Jeremiah, and the prophets, the kingdom of God. In Paul's letter, we read a whole bunch of ways that we might do that. In giving, and generosity, and leadership, and teaching. We are all appointed by God to a task. And the Son of the living God, what does that mean? Well, in ancient Israel, they didn't think of it as ancient Israel, they just thought of it as Israel, obviously. A son was often chosen to do the work of the father because they could be relied on to do the same type of job. They would be relied on to make the same decisions. You could trust the prince to make the decision the king would have made. That sort of thing. And Jesus is the Son of the living God. We can trust Jesus to do as God would do. Trinitarian theology, it gets a bit complicated. God, we often have that picture in our mind. Comic book, cartoon picture once again, old man, clouds, beard, nothing like what God actually is, but, you know. For me, I want to focus on the living. There are many things in our world which people hold very highly and important. You might almost say they worship them. But they are idols. They are not things that are living. The God whom we gather together to worship is a living God that is full of spirit, soul, and life. And God pours that out on us and asks of us, his anointed, to go into the world and pour that same spirit out on all in need. So let's make sure that as we build our church, we build it of living rocks to support us a roof for those in need, rather than gates that lock people out. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Amen. Amen.